Hi everyone, and welcome to this evening's event, in which we're going to be hearing from two incredible authors about their work and their thoughts on the fantastic. Susanna Clarke is the author of two masterpieces of speculative fiction, Jonathan Strange and Mr Norrell, and Piranesi. The first is set in an alternative version of 19th century England. It came out in 2004 and it earned Clarke widespread critical and commercial success. It was also filmed as a BBC drama in 2015. Susanna published a short story collection, The Ladies of Grace Adieu, set in the same universe as Jonathan Strange, in 2006. And Piranesi was published in 2020 and crowned winner of the Women's Prize for Fiction 2021. Alan Moore is widely regarded as the best and most influential writer in the history of comics. His seminal works include From Hell, V for Vendetta, and The League of Extraordinary Gentlemen. He's also the author of the best-selling novel Jerusalem, and most recently, his first ever short story collection, Illuminations, which I have here. We're going to start this evening with a real treat. Both authors are going to give us a very short reading from their most recent works. So, Alan, over to you. What have you chosen to read for us?
Well, I was going to read a story called Location, 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 or a little bit of the story. It needs a little bit of setting up, otherwise you won't understand any of it. This was a few years ago. I'd heard about the Panacean Trust over in Bedford, which were a group of women in the early 20th century who became obsessed with Joanna Southcott, the visionary, the woman clothed in the sun. And they had the box that she had said should not be opened until the apocalypse. They actually owned this box. So they'd bought a terraced house for Jesus to live in when he returned, as he obviously would after the apocalypse, and they had reasoned, probably quite correctly, that he would want to live in Bedford. They had their own reasons, I'm sure. But anyway, this story is basically, I was thinking, yeah, that's really funny. What if it was true? Which was the beginning of this story. Location, location, location. Bedford approached perfection. Angie checked the dashboard clock. It was a bit before 10:30 on that final Sunday morning, with no people on the streets and, other than her own, no moving vehicles. All things considered, an unusually pretty August day. Progressing eastward down deserted Mill Street, the subdued purr of the Astra's engine seemed almost embarrassing against an otherwise uninterrupted silence, like some noisy child she had unwisely taken to a funeral. She made a right turn into Castle Road before she reached the looming church spire of St. Cuthbert's, indicating only out of habit. There was nobody behind her. Sun rays fell in columns, beautifully dappling the pavements and parked cars outside the John Bunyan Museum as she passed it on her right. The mottled light resulting from that last day's atmospheric circumstances. Angie's weather app, for once, had been entirely accurate. The heavens shall be made a sea of glass, like unto crystal, wherein seven candlesticks shall be displayed. Essaying a smooth curve into the Castle Road's main stretch, she only counted four of these, baroque, floating immensities that made the stomach flip to look at them, but had no doubt the other three were lost from view, somewhere behind the tall trees rising at this end of Newnham Road. She made an effort to ignore the sky, just as she did her best to screen out all the other troubling elements of that eventful weekend, through a single-minded concentration on her duties as the Charitable Trust's executor. The beneficiary of the bequest, back in town after a long period away, would meet her at the property in a few minutes for a viewing and a handing over of the keys and necessary documents. She had no clear idea of her career arc after that, nor where she saw herself in 12 months' time. Parking a short walk from the Albany Road junction, Angie noticed that one of the red brick terraced houses on the street's far side still had a sun-bleached Brexit Party poster in its downstairs window. Was it really just the end of last year when all that stuff had been going on, with half the population busily anticipating world's end while the other half prepared for paradise? Above the castle mound and hidden river to the south, there was a beast that had a lion's head, plus six wings crowned with heavy-lidded and incurious eyes. This surely was the worst possible outcome, one where absolutely everybody turned out to be right. Sighing resignedly, she climbed out of the car. It was a glorious day. Its air was clean and fresh, with, on the breeze, a menthol redolence that she identified as incense, perhaps eucalyptus. Also, once outside the Astra, her discovery that the pervasive hush was laced with distant birdsong made the Enterprise seem less intimidating, although only slightly. Over the far end of Castle Road, off to the east, a second towering eminence presided. This one with a bull's head, but the same six wings folded around it like enormous fans, the same indifference in their thousands of unblinking eyes. The birds were nice, though. Still a few yards from the Albany Road turning, she was briefly startled by her first sight of the client, glimpsed across the box-cut privet bordering the corner house. Standing in the middle of the road in front of his new residence, he had his back to her and appeared to be contemplating the allotments on Albany Road's far side, directly opposite his garden gate and white front door, both for the moment closed against him. Though she'd done her best to banish any preconceptions, he was nothing like what she'd expected. Not so tall, for one thing, perhaps fleshier. He had on a rust-coloured summer jacket worn with matching slacks and what seemed to be Air Max trainers. Mousy collar-length hair with blonde tips and highlights, something like a mullet. He was vaping, sipping intermittently from a stylized gold fountain pen as he surveyed the straggling allotment. Confident now that her navy trouser suit and near homeopathic trace of makeup had been the correct decision, Angie called a breezy greeting as she tick-tocked into Albany's deserted quiet. Hi, I'm guessing you're my 10:30 to see the house. I'm Angie from Carstairs and Calderwood. I hope you haven't been here long. He turned at her and smiled, sipping the vape pen into his breast pocket. Oh no, only a few minutes. I arrived a little early anyway, wanted a bit of time to wallow in nostalgia, I suppose, and get a feel for how the place is now. Nice to meet you, Angie.
Fantastic, Alan. And can you just give us a little clue? What's this guy's name? What name is he going to give Angie in a few paragraphs?
A bit later on, he looks down. She asks what she should call him because she doesn't want to get into trouble. Should it be Your Highness or Your Holiness? And he looks down at his band t-shirt, which has got, I may be old, but I saw all the best bands. And he laughs self-deprecatingly and says, well, I suppose in this outfit, I must look like a bit of a jazz, mustn't I? And so she says, jazz it is. And then they go in to see
Excellent.
The prophecy.
Well, it's well worth a read if you haven't read it yet. Susanna, are you going to read us a little bit from Piranesi?
I am. Piranesi is about a man who lives in a house in which an ocean is imprisoned. And the book is really his entries in his journal. So this is from very, very close to the beginning, where he describes his world, which is the house. So this is one of his journal entries. A description of the world. Entry for the seventh day of the fifth month in the year the Albatross came to the southwestern halls. I am determined to explore as much of the world as I can in my lifetime. To this end, I have travelled as far as the 960th hall to the west, the 890th hall to the north, and the 768th hall to the south. I have climbed up to the upper halls, where clouds move in slow procession and statues appear suddenly out of the mists. I have explored the drowned halls, where the dark waters are carpeted with white water lilies. I have seen the derelict halls of the east, where ceilings, floors, sometimes even walls have collapsed, and the dimness is split by shafts of grey light. In all these places, I have stood in doorways and looked ahead. I have never seen any indication that the world was coming to an end, but only the regular progression of halls and passageways into the far distance. No hall, no vestibule, no staircase, no passage is without its statues. In most halls, they cover all the available space, though here and there you will find an empty plinth, niche or apse, or even a blank space on a wall otherwise encrusted with statues. These absences are as mysterious in their way as the statues themselves. I have observed that while the statues of a particular hall are more or less uniform in size, there is considerable variation between halls. In some places, the figures are two or three times the height of a human being, in others, more or less life-size, and in yet others, only reach as high as my shoulder. The drowned halls contain statues that are gigantic, 15 to 20 metres high, but they are the exception. The windows of the house look out upon great courtyards, barren, empty places paved with stone. The courtyards are generally four-sided, although now and then you will come upon one with six sides or eight, or even, these are rather strange and gloomy, only three. Outside the house, there are only the celestial objects, sun, moon, and stars. The house has three levels. The lower halls are the domain of the tides. Their windows, when seen from across a courtyard, are grey-green with the restless waters and white with the spatter of foam. The lower halls provide nourishment in the form of fish, crustaceans, and sea vegetation. The upper halls are, as I have said, the domain of the clouds. Their windows are grey-white and misty. Sometimes you will see a whole line of windows suddenly illuminated by a flash of lightning. The upper halls give fresh water, which is shed in the vestibules in the form of rain and flows in streams down walls and staircases. Between these two largely uninhabitable levels are the middle halls, which are the domain of birds and of men. The beautiful orderliness of the house is what gives us life. This morning, I looked out of a window in the 18th southeastern hall. On the other side of the courtyard, I saw the other looking out of a window. The window was tall and dark. The other's noble head, with its high forehead and neatly trimmed beard, was framed in one corner. He was lost in thought, as he so often is. I waved to him. He did not see me. I waved more extravagantly. I jumped up and down with great energy. But the windows of the house are many, and he did not see me.
Thank you, Susanna. That was wonderful. I'm there in the house, lapped by ocean. Amazing. Thank you both so much of you. What a way to spend a Thursday evening hearing you both read from your books. Now, we are going to be chatting for about 45 minutes and then I'll be asking Alan and Susanna some of your questions. So do send them in. So we've got lots to talk about. Alan and Susanna, I wanted to start by casting your minds back to early reading experiences. This is because reading Piranesi, Susanna, you start with a quote from The Magician's Nephew. And this cast me back to my childhood reading of that book and made me realise, I think for the first time, that it was that book that really opened me up to reading and to the fantastic. When you realise the links with The Lion, the Witch and the Wardrobe, that you see the tree that the wardrobe is made from, it just sort of lit me up with the joy of literature. I found it really joyful. How about you both? Do you have a particular book that you can trace your joy in literature and the fantastic back to? Alan, let's start with you because Susanna's just read us all that.
Well, there are probably many, many books that I could refer to, but the one that sticks in my mind actually does have something in common with Piranesi. It was the first book that really taught me what could be done with fantasy and writing and the human imagination, that would probably have been Mervyn Peake's Titus Groan, which I read when I was about 13. And I remember that the first chapter, when I was 13, I thought it was incredibly dull because all it was talking about was the architecture of Gormenghast. It was just creating this huge, ponderous architecture of endless stone corridors and the Hall of Bright Carvings and the Room of Roots. But it was, I realised before I'd finished the book, I'd realised why Peake had done that in the first chapter, because it is creating an architecture. It's creating a metaphysical architecture that will probably remain for much of your life. I mean, there are places that I've visited in the real world that I've completely forgotten about, but I still remember the Hall of Bright Carvings and the Room of Roots. A fantasy, a brilliant fantasy, actually constructs itself inside the reader's mind, which is one of the things that I thought, yeah, it's a completely different book to Piranesi, but there's that architectural quality in what Susanna has done in that book, which reminded me of Peake more than it reminded me of anybody. Just those, yeah, putting it down word by word, stone by stone, until you've actually built the structure inside the reader's imagination, you know. So, yeah, the Gormenghast books were probably the first books that alerted me to what could be done with writing with sufficient drive, you know.
How interesting. Well, the same question to you, Susanna, but before we get to that, is there anything of Peake for you in Piranesi? Was that in your mind at all?
I think so. There were things that were more in my mind, notably Luis Borges, and also to a certain extent C.S. Lewis, because it does sort of have these echoes of The Magician's Nephew. So if you cross Borges and C.S. Lewis, you sort of get Piranesi. But I mean, I did. Yes, Gormenghast was there, and it is quite nerve-wracking writing a book and beginning it with pages and pages of description of statues and staircases. And you think no one's going to want to read this. And so, I don't know if Peake actually had that same sort of anxiety, but I definitely did. Yeah.
Maybe publishing into a less commercial marketplace.
But it is a bit nerve-wracking, yeah. But some readers would have been quite happy if Piranesi was nothing but description. Some readers just felt so at home that they would have been okay with it, actually. I guess for me, unsurprisingly, the books which... When I look back at my childhood, the books that dominated are the Narnia books. It just was a world in which I felt completely at home. But I think it's what Alan's talking about. It wasn't that I realised fantasy literature did something different perhaps from other literature. I just felt more at home in Narnia and in other similar books, perhaps historical books. I just always felt more at home in somewhere that wasn't the modern world. It made more sense to me. And then in my teenage years, I read Ursula Le Guin's Earthsea. And despite that being in many ways a sort of archetypal fantasy with wizards and dragons, it was so real, and it gave me something which I was missing in my actual life. I was thinking about this. My life as a teenager was sort of, there were two poles. There was church and there was school. And in both of these, this was in Bradford in West Yorkshire in the 1970s, in both of these, there were very both places require that you behave in very particular ways and believe very particular things. School as much as church, I would say. And neither of these were ways that I felt were particularly me. So books like Earthsea sort of made a place for my emotions and made a place for my dreams and my intellect. And I was, you know, I was at home there. And just as Alan said, if I look to the, to not so much to the architecture, but to the landscape of some of those islands that make up Earthsea, particularly the farthest west island, Celidor, the description that I know that place, I feel I have walked there. I know it better than I know most places in the real world.
Yeah, I feel like the Earthsea books are so, they're so pure and true in terms of the fantasy. You feel like it is these clear drops of fantasy just coming to you right from the source.
Yes.
Both of your work is so deeply rooted in the fantastical and in the rich history of that genre, from Piranesi and its the architectural fantasies of Giovanni Battista Piranesi to the wonders and the monsters of the League of Extraordinary Gentlemen, Alan, and all of the places they come from. I was rereading the first one the other evening, and I hadn't noticed before Katie Carr, who I was delighted to see there from What Katie Did, sort of sadistic Katie Carr in the school. That made me very happy. Anyway, for both of you, was fantastical the fantastical always the genre you were going to be drawn to writing in, and what draws you to it, Susanna?
No, yes. I originally was writing a detective novel, and that was what I wanted to write, because I read quite a lot of detective novels. I feel I like them. There's something I enjoy, and that was what I was going to do, but I could not do it. The plot, my mind doesn't work in that way, or it didn't then, and all these sort of slightly eerie atmospheres kept coming in, and this sort of surrealism kept sort of drifting in. And in the end, I just had to, after years of trying, I had to give it up. And then I wasn't going to be a writer, because I thought I failed as a writer. That's fine. I'll do something else. But then fantasy just sort of leaving detective fiction, crime fiction, and just sort of made fantasy well up more and more. And then I started writing something which eventually became Strange and Norrell, although it started a very long way from where it finished up. But yeah, it is something that just makes more sense to me than other sorts of writing. I've also been rereading Alan and what he has to say about meaning and symbolism. And I feel that fantasy literature, good fantasy literature, it gives meaning to the reader. In it, the reader finds a world which is meaningful. And so much of the world that we actually live in, we feel, probably wrongly, but we feel is meaningless. So we find meaning in fantasy literature.
Is there something in particular in Alan's work that you're thinking of there?
I have to say it's Promethea, which I think shaped me in ways that I haven't read it for a long time, but I've been rereading it this afternoon, and it had a profound effect on me. It is the story of a woman who becomes, she's the living embodiment of imagination, which is what we are talking about. We are talking about imagination. And she is what, she brings the blessings of imagination to mankind. And she also goes on a long journey through heaven following the Kabbalah. So that, that I love that. Not everyone's cup of tea, maybe, but that absolutely mine.
Excellent. Same question to you, Alan. Was the fantastical always where you were going to end up? I mean, you've written all sorts of things, I
Probably
know.
it was always something where I was always going to be fairly invested in the fantastical. I mean, the beginnings of it were magical children's stories, and particularly once I discovered mythology, I was devouring all of the Greek myths, the Roman myths, particularly the Norse myths. And I think that the thing I liked about them was that they were full of things that never happened. Other books had things that do happen and or could possibly happen. But sort of, I thought that things that can't possibly happen have got to be the most attractive and wonderful things of all. So, yeah, it was pretty much a straight progression from mythology to superhero comics and science fiction and fantasy at a very young age. And fantasy is a very big word that covers a lot of territory. I mean, looked at in one way, fantasy is a big kind of mother genre in which you could easily include science fiction and horror and all the rest of it. So, yes, I've always been entranced by a good fantasy, but it has to be a good fantasy. It has to be something, well, like Ursula K. Le Guin's Earthsea, which I've just today ordered. Melinda suggested that I order it for my grandson, Rowan. We're just running out of the fantasy trilogy that he's reading at the moment, and we thought, hey, Earthsea, that would be that, because I remember I read that in my 20s, and yeah, that has got something special. It might be a conventional fantasy in a fantasy universe, but that is one that I would make an exception for, because there is just something so human about the characters, irrespective of the world that they're in. It is saying something about real emotional human life. I think that all fantasies have to be grounded somewhere. In dreams, in emotions, but they have to be grounded in something that actually touches human life. Otherwise, I don't think that they would be the wonderful kind of sanctuary that Susanna was talking about. Because yes, they are. A great fantasy book is a world of its own, and it's a world of your own. But I don't think that they would be quite as appealing if they were completely divorced from any human consequences or any human situations, even emotional situations. You know, I guess I can probably think of loads of exceptions to my own rule, but sort of, you know, there are a lot of things that are pure fantasy, don't seem to relate to anything but themselves, and they're wonderful. But in general, I prefer it if there is some connection, you know, something, you know, just connecting it to the human experience, but taking that human experience into a completely previously unimagined space.
Do you read much of fantasy that's published contemporarily, Alan? And do you have thoughts about it?
I don't read very much. I've read some. I mean, the probably the last fantasy book that I read would have been Piranesi. That sort of that before that, I mean, there are exceptions. There are things like, say, Brian Catlin's Vore trilogy, which was I found stupefying. And I tend to like old weird fantasy books like David Lindsay's Voyage to Arcturus, which is one of those books that is probably unfathomable. It is complete fantasy. The characters are developing new sense organs with each new world they move into. It's probably some vast Gnostic allegory that I've not completely penetrated, but gives such a wonderful feeling, or William Hype Hodgson's House on the Borderland. You know, it's sort of fantasy can be an awful lot of things. That is the thing that I like about it. It's what I object to is when it's not so much even traditional fantasy that I object to, but it's when people insist that everything be traditional fantasy or it isn't fantasy. You know, fantasy is a much bigger word than I think people give it credit for.
Absolutely. So you recently read Piranesi. What did you think of it?
What did I thought it was magnificent. It's sort of like I was saying earlier that sort of it actually creates an architectural metaphysical space. It's more than a book. It is metaphysical architecture. You know, and I can understand why a lot of readers, Susanna was saying that they'd have been quite happy if she just went on describing all the rooms and all the statues. I can understand that, you know. And, I mean, it has a wonderful plot as well, which was some... I mean, from the moment when there's a bit in Piranesi where you describe the skeletons, the skeletons that Piranesi is looking after that he's found around the house. And... one of them is wrapped around a Huntley and Palmer's biscuit tin. And that was a really spine-tingling moment. The introduction, I mean, usually with fantasy, it's the real situation. And the spine-tingling moment is something of the fantastical that suddenly manifests in that situation. But what Susanna had put forward was the perfect reverse of that, where all of a sudden it's the Huntley and Palmer's biscuit that are the uncanny object, you know. That was remarkable, and there were lots of touches like that. Sort of, yeah, it's sort of, I thought it was a magnificent book. I mean, and that is of Strange and Norrell, but I thought that Piranesi, it was a different level. I'm not, you know, I don't want to compare them because that would make Strange and Norrell, which was a different book, sound like the lesser of the two, which it isn't, you know. But I was just so impressed by this. It was a completely different level of accomplishment, or it seemed so to me, that just this, because Strange and Norrell has got a few tropes that are recognisable from other things, whereas Piranesi had none that I could see. I mean, I'm sure that, yeah, I get the Boyes reference particularly. I've been looking at some Boyes lately, you know, and sort of stories like Salon Akbar, Orbis Tertius, which is the imaginary world that scholars are creating in this encyclopedia, but it somehow exists. If that much is known about it and has been written about it, then it somehow exists. I can see that in relation to Piranesi. It's reaching, like Boyes did, it's reaching beyond fantasy to some degree for something that's kind of ineffable, you know.
It's quite a write-up there for you, Susanna. Wow,
it's amazing.
And you've got you. Thank you. You said a little earlier before the event started that Piranesi itself draws a little from Alan's own work.
Yeah. There was a sense that I wanted the house to feel a bit, to be very, very strange, and at the same time to feel slightly familiar. And I realised that I was drawing on something Alan said at the end of Promethea. At the end of the Promethea, I don't want to give too much of the plot away. There's a house,
that's
which has many. I think it's quite difficult to give the plot of Promethea away, actually. You'd have to talk for quite a while to do so. But at the end, there's a house with many, many rooms. And people just find themselves in this house. And at one point, one of the characters says, haven't you dreamt of this house or a house very like it with lots of staircases and rooms and you're just going through this huge house? And I thought, yes, I have. I have dreamt of that house. I know I have on many occasions. And people also, I think this is right, people go to different rooms and find themselves in different periods of their life. And as I get older, that house is truer and truer for me because I'm now 64 and I feel almost that I could go into a different room and into my teenage years or go into a different room and into my, these things are quite close. And I'm sure as it gets, as I get older, that there's this sort of sense. So that sense of the familiarity of that huge house, I not only drew on Alan, but I took courage from what he'd written there to think maybe people will find this not only just a really weird house, but a little bit familiar. And I think some, I think people have actually, yeah.
I mean, yeah. The house that I was basing it on is one that I thought that only turned up in my dreams. It's probably different houses, although it always feels like the same one.
Yeah.
I don't know if this is true of yours, your house, Susanna, but in mine, the stairways are often like blocked with old school desks or something like that. There are impediments. It's difficult to get from room to room and floor to floor, and you can never find your way back to the place that you really liked and wanted to find your way back to.
Yes.
I suppose that the house, as you were saying about the rooms where your teenage self is or your 30-year-old self or whatever, I guess the house has got to be our lives, hasn't it?
Yeah.
Purely and simply, it's our lives where some of the stairways are blocked with old school desks, you know, or things like that. Yeah.
It's definitely one of the things it is. I also tend to dream about houses, which I think is my house, and then I find there's a whole other level. This is very Jungian, that's filled with lumber and stuff that's sort of decaying. That's it's a bit disturbing, really.
Susanna and Alan, you met ages ago because Susanna, you interviewed Alan about Lost Girls when it came out. Yes. I read that interview, which is a fantastic interview. I would definitely recommend it to anyone who wants to find out more about Alan and Lost Girls. But you talk in that about your experience of reading Watchmen for the first time and how it kind of turned the world grey for you because you wanted to be in the book all of the time. Tell us about that feeling, which all us readers know well.
I was not allowed to read comics when I was growing up, and I was a girl and I was a child, and I definitely wasn't the market, but I was fascinated by comics. But it was sort of frowned upon. This isn't for you, you know, because you're a girl and you're respectable, and this isn't for you. And you're intellectual also, you know, you can't read Jane Austen and comics. That's not, you know, in the 1970s and 80s, that was clearly not a thing you could do. But I worked in Covent Garden, my first job, and I could walk to Forbidden Planet, which was then a bit closer to Covent Garden than it is now. And I used to go in full of boys, full of young men, and I would very nervously go in and I would look at these Alan Moore graphic novels and think, dare I buy one? And eventually I did dare buy one, and it was Watchmen. And I read it over a weekend, or most of it over a weekend, and I could not stop reading it. And it possessed me in the way no other book has before or since. It got to Sunday night, and I thought, I've got to stop reading this because I've got to go to work in the morning. So very regretfully, I put it down. And the next day I went to work and I felt ill. I felt ill of not reading the book. It was just really, I mean, it was physically, I felt completely unsettled and ill. And that I'd promised myself foolishly that I would wait till the following weekend to finish it. Of course I didn't. The moment I walked in the door, I picked it up. I don't think I took my coat off. And I just read it until I finished. And then I suppose I was ill of not having the book to read anymore. But it was quite extraordinary. I mean, it was not just imagination, but it was operatic. So many things were going on at the same time. And because it was the form, the medium it was, it was very, very difficult to do this in prose. I don't know what Alan thinks, but in a graphic novel, you can have the speech doing one thing, you can have the picture doing another thing, and you can have something else symbolizing a heart. You can have three or four strands going. And I had never realized that anyone could do that. I wouldn't dare try it in prose. The closest I got to it was the footnotes in Jonathan Strange and Mr. Norrell. But I do envy
That's a good
being able. But it's not quite the same. Opera, you can do it in opera because you can have people singing completely different lines of melody, and you can make and they can be singing, they can have be having completely different emotions. And because it's music, you can make sense of the whole and you can follow the individual. But I think it's if you try to do it in prose, it would just get embarrassingly tricksy very quickly.
Well, I think that certainly there are things. I mean, I am my comics past is largely behind me at the moment, and I'm not going to be working in comics again because I am persuaded that actually prose fiction is there are beautiful things that you can do in comics, but prose fiction is just so eloquent. Elegant because there are 26 characters and a peppering of punctuation, and from that you can create the entire universe. It's
Yes.
sort of I mean with comics, yes, you have got other layers that you can work with, as Susanna was saying. There's the dialogue, there's the captions, there's the pictures, there's any symbols that you've embedded in the pictures that can have their own narrative. There's all sorts of things. I mean, like when we first met Susanna and Colin when they came up to interview us about Lost Girls. It was. I mean, with Lost Girls, that was a fantasy. Yeah, very much a fantasy work where we were actually dealing with sexual fantasy, which is probably the most common kind of fantasy in the world, if we're going not in terms of printed fantasy, although it's probably that as well. But the way that we could actually take these three characters from children's fiction, Wendy, Dorothy, and Alice, and actually, so we're talking about the imagination. You can use comics to do that in a more subtle way. You can have, just juxtapositions between what you're showing in the picture. And I mean, in one of the sequences in Lost Girls, we have a very, very repressed couple having a very boring late night conversation. But their shadows on the wall behind them. We set up the panels so that their shadows are behaving orgiastically while they're sort of talking about really dull everyday things, and they don't like each other much. So, you can do wonderful things with that. But no, I mean, thank you very much for that assessment, Suzanne. That's really good. I'm glad that I've still got the power to make people feel physically ill.
I love the way you put that, Alan. 26 characters and a peppering of punctuation.
The other thing I was thinking about this afternoon about one of the things. I don't know if this is right, but it occurred to me that when you were doing comics, people sort of made you the responsible for the whole of comicdom. Because you were the leader, you were the one forging ahead. I presume you don't feel quite as responsible for the whole of English literature in the way people made you responsible for the whole of comics.
This is why working in literature is a huge relief.
Yes, I would think.
You know, it's like when people sort of, yeah, they people talk about comics and they, even though I'm trying to sort of distance myself a little bit from comics, but yeah, it's always, yeah, I know that in the first sentence of my obituary, the word Watchmen is going to be in there somewhere, isn't it? It's sort of, but that is less likely to happen in the field of just general literature. Although I did, in my novel Jerusalem, I put a quote on the back that I'd received, and I think this is the best jacket quote of all time. It was from a 9-year-old schoolboy in Naseby Primary School, and he had written me this letter. It was a lovely letter, and he just said, "All in all, I think that you are the best author in human history. Please write back." So that was the quote that we put on the back of Jerusalem. I did write back, and I said, "The best author in human history. In your face, Shakespeare, Cervantes." So yeah, I'm not likely to get singled out so much in the broader field of literature as I was in comics. So yeah, that's a weight off my shoulders.
Yeah. Oh wow, what a lucky little boy to be on the book. That's brilliant. Let's talk a bit about magic. How, as a writer, you come up with something that convinces, how you write it, the wellspring of literature that you draw from when you're writing it. Susanna, let's start with Jonathan Strange and magic there, which has obviously been absent from England for some time when Mr. Norrell admits to being able to do it. How did you make your magic work in that book?
I didn't. Somebody asked, I think the director asked me when they were filming it for television, he said, "How does the magic actually work?" And I said, "I don't know." You know, it's very much a literary sort of magic, but it's also, I wanted it to be, the book to be a bit about English landscape and the sort of way I felt, sort of bringing something out of English landscape, because I love English landscape, I guess particularly Northern English landscape. I spent most of my life probably in the north half of England, and I yeah. So I felt, as the book went on, at the beginning it was very sort of spells and books and things, but as it goes on, it's really more about things coming out of England and the strength of England and the fairies who have a kind of, who are more connected. So I think, and this is probably true of Piranesi as well, the magic sort of more and more represents the spaces between systems, the spaces between disciplines, the space, the experiences we have that we can't quite elucidate, describe, and therefore which slip very easily out of our minds because we don't actually, we can't describe them in words. So it might be religious experience, or it might be spiritual experience, or it might be landscape or animals or something, but it's the bits of our experience that we feel deeply that connect down to our subconscious, but which we can't fit in very easily to a system or a philosophy. Does that make any sense at all?
Makes perfect sense. Yeah, I can see exactly what you mean there. I mean, it's magic is, it's a point of transition or something like that, from one system to another. And in fiction, it is just the word magic will allow you to do almost anything, you know, because nobody knows what magic really is, even all of the self-styled magicians, because we're all self-styled. It's not like anybody's actually handing out diplomas for this stuff, you know. But you know, magic is entirely a thing of the mind. I don't believe that it can do anything in the physical world, but look what it can do in the mind. Look what it can do in fiction. And also, it does, like what Susanna was saying about how Strange and Norrell had kind of, was the magic became more about something that grows out of the landscape itself. I think that that's really important. It's sort of the places that we inhabit, they are all magical places. But the course of centuries, they have become disenchanted, literally. In that we walk down these boring modern streets day after day, all throughout our lives, and that's all they are. They're boring modern streets because they've become disenchanted. It is possible through writing to re-enchant these places. It is possible to either, as Susanna's done, to create a completely fantastic other world that is there in people's heads, or you can focus upon some part of the real physical world that we exist in and make that magical by studying, looking at its history, looking at the mythology of the space, looking at the stories that are connected to it, because in a way they are as real and as important, possibly more important, than the physical bricks and mortar. Yes, there is the physical nature of spaces, but when we think of places, that's not what we're thinking about. We're thinking about our emotional reactions and our memories and the fictions and the fantasies and the legends that we associate with a place. That, to my mind, is much more real.
Is that what you're setting out to do in Jerusalem, Alan, bringing that magic to that small section of Northampton?
Yeah, well, yes, it was. I mean, I'd previously done Voice of the Fire, which was about the whole county of Northampton. And I thought, actually, that's far too far-ranging, and I should be a much more conservative in my next book and just do it about a block or two. But yeah, it's the most deprived area in Northampton still. It was where I grew up. And all of the mythology, all of the legends, they're all there. They're in the original. I really wanted Jerusalem to come out with based on a true story, because it kind of is. There is very little in that book that's made up. Yes, I do know angels and demons and gods and things like that. No, it's all of the characters in there, and most of the events are as they happened. But with a certain cast, they can all be seen as magical. And I have had people say that when they walk through Northampton now, people from out of town, that they'll think, oh, that's the street where that happened in Jerusalem. So it creates an overlay. Mm-hmm. London, if we think about Victorian London, we're inevitably not thinking about Victorian London. We're probably thinking about Charles Dickens. Because fictions become part of the places that they're talking about. You know, this is one of the uses of fantasy. I think perhaps it's perhaps the best use of fantasy, in that it is a really sophisticated way of actually modifying reality. You know, sort of everything in the material world did come out of somebody's imagination. We are living amongst our unpacked imagination. So to me, it seems like there's almost like a membrane between things that do happen and things that don't happen, between fact and between fiction, and that things, this membrane must be semi-permeable, because sometimes things slip through in one direction or the other. Sometimes you get people who are completely real but will end up as fictional. It can happen. And on the other hand, you'll get things that only existed in fiction that will, like cyber attacks that we were talking about earlier, that will somehow come through the membrane and then they're part of the real world. I think of the world of fiction and the world of fact as being two necessary parts of the same thing. I don't think this world would function physically if it didn't have its fantasy component. I don't think we would function without that vital fantasy component, whether it's in our dreams at night or whether it's in our literature.
There's a wonderful story, the first story of Voice of the Fire, which is actually quite a horrific story in some ways, but it's set way, 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 way back. I don't know what you would call it, when most people were still nomad, and there's some people who have settled down in communities, but there's no way to physically get from one part of England to another, because there's no roads and no sense. There's no sense, really, that if you go on a walk, when you go on the walk the second time, it'll be the same. It might be completely different. The trees might have moved or whatever. And somebody decides to make a road so that you can go from one place to another and you can do it again. And this is a radical, enormously radical idea. But the road is not a physical thing. It's a poem. The first road was a poem. And that is how deeply literature goes into landscape and literature. It was an extraordinary, what it is a sort of set of instructions that somebody could remember for going from one place to another and then doing it again, and possibly even coming back, which was so radical at that time. I think it's an extraordinary thing.
Well, I'd heard the expression songline, talking about the Aboriginal people in Australia and their songlines, which were how their dream time was constructed. And I thought, so what's a songline? I kind of know what they mean, but what is it? And I was thinking, we didn't invent maps until relatively late in the day. So how did we get anywhere before we'd worked out two-dimensional representations of a three-dimensional territory? And I thought, well, the only way you could do it is with mnemonics. And the best form of mnemonics is rhyme. That is probably one of the reasons why we invented poetry to start with. Probably not for decoration or for entertainment, but probably for purely practical reasons. You know, walk to the lightning-blasted tree and then you shall in Norfolk be. something like that. And then there'd be further directions, you know, sort of, you know, walk past these rocks, carry on towards the setting sun in a straight line, and then you'll be in this place. And, I mean, in fact, the Northampton is on something called the Jurassic Way, which was, I think it was Edward Smith, the father of English geology, who had identified this limestone ridge that ran all the way from Lincoln down to Bath. And that would have been one of the first tracks that actually made this country into a country, from a bunch of settled sort of nomad communities or whatever. That would have connected everything up, and it would have been connected up, I'm pretty sure, with a song. So yeah, Susanna's right. This is, there is that great poem from, I think it's G.K. Chesterton, before the Romans up from Gwent or out of Severn strode, the rolling English drunkard made the rolling English road. there's a poetry to it, whichever way you look at it. You know, it's not that poetry is a long way from drinking excessively. Yeah. You know, so sort of,
Amazing. I'm going to start asking you guys some questions from our brilliant listeners now, because loads have come in and I want to try and get through some of them. So Phil is asking if Alan could give us a brief taster of what we can expect from the Long London cycle of books, which are out when, Alan?
I believe, and my publishers might be throwing up their hands in horror at this moment, but I believe it's possibly September this year. Mm-hmm. Or around then, autumn this year, I think. It's completed. As to what you can expect from it, I hope you'll find... I didn't know what it was going to be like when I started writing it. I knew what the story was eventually, and that the first book is set in 1949. And it deals with... it's London after the war, where a big hole has been blown in everything. London and England are in ruins, psychologically and physically. And there is the suggestion of another world, another London, that is all about, it's a symbolist London, if you like. It's some kind of, it's the meaning of London, the mythology of London, the imagination of London that precedes the actual physical London itself. And it's a sort of an archetypal London where the things that happen there, we are just a shadow. It's this long London is the stuff that's going on outside Plato's cave. And we are the shadows on the wall. That's the basic setup. The second book will jump ahead to 1959, and then 1969, 1979, and then an unexplained 20-year gap before 1999. So it's a lot of it's about British history in the last century, and it will possibly turn out to be a lot about our present century, which will probably remain off stage throughout the entire series, but that might be what I'm talking about. That sort of the way that the symbolic reality that underpins all human life is, I think, in the present day, broken, possibly demolished. That the things that gave us meaning and values and ideologies. I think that's also 20th century. That's so last millennium. I think that we're in a different territory now. And that is one of the things that I want to talk about in Long London. But it's got some pretty good fantasy stuff in it as well, I've got to say. I don't want to give very much of it away, but... I've tried to come up with some quite original things, and it's got the most horrible talking cat that you've possibly ever imagined.
Excellent. Well, that sounds amazing. Susanna, can you give us any indication of what you're working on at the moment? What's next from you?
Bradford. I'm working on a book about Bradford, because who doesn't want to read a book about Bradford? I mean, absolutely. So this is very much what Alan was talking about a place and what it means and what it meant to me, because I was there. The difficulty is I lived there a long time ago in the 70s, but it was a sort of, I was a teenager, and I think a place where you grew up as a teenager is hugely important and hugely, you know, has a great effect on you, a huge emotional effect. So it isn't about my life, but bits of my life keep coming in. And because it's a book by me, there is an Italian, all my books seem to have an Italian bit. So yeah, they leave Bradford and go to Italy for a bit and then they come back.
All right, exciting. Now, this next question from Ben, I am going to read out in its entirety because it's beautifully phrased. What is the role of good writing and good fantasy in a civilization facing threats from climate catastrophe, AI, bio and nuclear weapons, volatile geopolitics and too much paperwork? Thank you, and may the house fill your eyes with beauty. I'll give that to you, Susanna, because of the house.
Well, I think fantasy is hugely important as we face climate change and sort of environmental disaster, because what fantasy does, I think, I mean, literary fiction can do this as well, but I think fantasy is very good at the other, the non-human, whether that is devils, gods, God, the house, but also landscape, animals. It's very good at giving a view which is not the view we're locked into. That's what it's trying to do. Good fantasy and good writing is sort of to take us out of our 21st century heads. I mean, I think historical fiction could do this as well, which is why Jonathan Strange and Mr Norrell were both historical and fantasy, but it's sort of to get you out of that space and to show you another possibility and to give voice to the non-human, I think, is a very important thing.
Totally. Would you agree with that, Alan?
Yeah, I'd say that fantasy probably plays a vital role. I think that it is... What we need is a new way of seeing the world. I think that that is what we're vitally in need of, both in terms of our environment, in terms of our politics, in terms of most of the structures that actually make up the imaginary structures that nonetheless make up our material world. We have to be able to find a way to see a new world, to imagine one. And I think that, I mean, given the word has tremendous power, you know, nobody should ever underestimate the power of a well-written sentence, a well-written passage. They can change the world, if only in a small way, if only in one reader's mind. Or you could have, say, a book like Orwell's 1984, which arguably prevented the thing that he was talking about from happening, or at least in quite that way. That's not to say we aren't still menaced by the threat of totalitarian societies, but at least they probably won't do it in quite such a hackneyed way as they would have done if Orwell hadn't written that book. For example, in Northampton, where they tend to try out everything that would only be a remote fantasy for all of you people living in other parts of the country. I mean, you don't have little robot delivery boxes trundling along your streets, do you? But we do. And we've had the first, you know, the security cameras that are everywhere now, since I predicted them in V for Vendetta and everyone thought, oh, that'd be a good idea. We had in Northampton, we had security cameras that talked. Pick that cigarette end up. Yes, you. Until they realised, oh, this is just such crap, George Orwell. This is embarrassing. We're going to stop doing that because everyone's just laughing at us. So, yeah, things do change the world. It's sort of a couple of years ago, I got a request to write a letter to the people of Brazil when they were on the eve of their election. And I did, and Lula won and Bolsonaro got thrown out. And I've got no way of telling whether my writing this letter, which Lula posted to the Brazilian electorate, I've got no way of knowing whether that influenced the election in any way. But if it did, that is probably the best 3 hours of writing that I will ever do in my entire life. So, yeah, words can change things. And I think that, yeah, fantasy and to develop the human imagination, it's like a muscle. If you don't develop it, it won't exist. And fantasy, I think, gives people's minds a workout, you know.
Brilliant. I've got a nice question here from Morgan, which might end up being our last one unless we answer it very quickly. What fantasy world depicted in a work of fiction would either of you love to inhabit? It's a good question, I think. Maybe your house, Susanna.
I want to go to Earthsea. I'm not sure whether I want to stay there forever. Probably I would quite like to. I just want to walk on Celador for hours and hours. The silence and the solitariness are just sort of call to me.
So not go to wizard school then. Just go to the
Sorry?
go to the not go to wizard school there then.
No, I'm not that fussed. Once upon a time, I would definitely have wanted to go to a wizard school. I don't care that much about power anymore. And wizards are embarrassingly fond of power. And I kind of think it's a bit of a rabbit hole, really, now. So I'm not that bothered. I probably would like to go and live in one of Diana Wynne Jones's worlds.
Ooh, good call.
Because that is, I yeah. Possibly the world of the Merlin. No, I'm not going to get this
The
right.
Merlin conspiracy. I
The
just
Merlin conspiracy. It's
read that a few weeks ago.
my favorite Diana Wynne Jones book. And it's such a ridiculous title that I can never remember what it is. But I love that. Almost any of her worlds I would like to live in. But it's also living in a children's book would be just so much better than
Maybe meeting Crestomanci would be quite fun. How about you, Alan? Anywhere you'd go for sure?
I tend to think that just reading the books is living in them, for me. And I have such a tenuous grip upon actual reality anyway that I am kind of living in a fantasy world all the time. So it'd perhaps be a bit redundant if I was also living in Oz or Narnia or anywhere. You know, it's sort of actually my world seems as limited and prescribed as it is. It does seem quite fantastical to me, and more by the moment. I look at a newspaper or some incoming news headlines and. Yeah, that is about as much fantasy as I can take. Just current reality is a lot more abnormal than anything that I had previously dreamed of.
Yeah.
So I'm happy where I am. Thank
Okay.
you.
A dangerous question for you then. I think we can fit one more in. We've got like a minute left. And Tamsin has asked you both for a definition of fairy, thinking about sort of it in opposition to Disneyfication, asking what is fairy and why is it important? Maybe Susanna, you could start on that one with all of the fairy
Gosh.
world of Jonathan Strange.
Yeah, I ooh, that is really hard. I think fairy changes. And so it changes depending on where you are in your life. But for me, it becomes a sort of repository of all the non-human things that we are ignoring and abusing that whose voices we need to listen to. And it's also about having stroppy people like the fairy and Jonathan Strange and Mr. Norrell just being kind of completely immoral and doing all the things we wish we could do without any sense of consequences at all. But no, for me at the moment, I would say it is about giving a voice to the things we are ignoring in the world. But fairy is very malleable, it changes a lot.
Brilliant answer. How about you, Alan?
I'd say that Susanna's absolutely on the money there. I'd say that the notion of fairy, it is that which we have excluded from our world. It is either parts of ourselves that we are. I mean, one of the early names for fairyland or a variation on fairyland was Cocaine. which is a land of eternal, I think all the houses are made of food. It's a land of eternal indulgence. So an excluded part of us. And all of the other things, our behaviour, or any excluded group, we can, they're a bit fey. They're a bit otherworldly. Mm. It's the other.
Yeah, it's Jung's shadow, really, isn't it?
Yes, yeah. It is.
Oh, well, I'm glad I asked that question. Brilliant question and brilliant answers. But I'm afraid we've come to the end of our time. That is an hour and 15 minutes. It's gone past so fast. I've got a million more questions I could ask. But thank you all so much for listening. And thank you especially to Alan and Susanna for the most fantastic way to spend a Thursday evening. Oh, goodbye.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Bye-bye.